Good morning and welcome. I'm Earl Arnold. I'm a retired pastor living over in Owego at the Padgett Price Homes. I see some others of my friends here. And of course, Jeff Kellum lives just down the way from us. So I feel like I have some kind of a relationship with this congregation. And I'm so glad to see those of you who are members of the Union Presbyterian Church who are here this morning, and would like to welcome any of you who are here who are visiting today. And I hope that you will come out to our coffee hour and so we can welcome you in person. And we have our call to worship. If we would rise for our call to worship.
Shepherd of Israel, listen. You who lead Joseph like a flock, enthroned on the cherubim, shine forth. Rouse your valor and come to our help. God of hosts, come back, we pray. Look down from heaven and see our plight. Never again will we turn away from you. Give us life, and we will call upon your name. New life. The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence, in faith and in penitence. Let us confess our sin before God and one another. Prayer for wholeness and peace. Purifying God, we grow comfortable with the way things are in our lives, in the church and in the world. We do not often welcome new life you offered in Christ, for you overturn our notions of possessions, power, and protocol, wanting to have more and more. We exploit the resources of the world you have entrusted to us, with little concern for the needs of others or the future. Forgive us, we pray, for seeking our gain at the expense of others. Help us bend our lives toward your own life of self-giving and sacrifice. Fill us, our homes and churches, the whole world, with the abundant love of Christ until all are made new. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. With the whole church, we affirm that we are made in God's image, befriended by Christ, and empowered by the Spirit. With people everywhere, we affirm God's goodness at the heart of humanity, planted more deeply than all that is wrong. With all creation, we celebrate the miracle and wonder of life, and the unfolding purposes of God, forever at work in ourselves and the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. O God, teach us to be still and to know that you are God. Teach us to be still and to rest in your presence. May the peace of God be with you and also with you. Let us share the sign of God's peace with one another. A reading from the book of Isaiah, beginning at chapter 5, verse 1. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed it out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry.
Do you have a garden? Sort of. A little patch of dirt where you grow things and you've put some seeds in. We don't have, well, actually we have room for a garden, but it's too much work. So what we have is on our back porch, we have four pots that we are growing things in. We have two pots that have cucumbers and two pots that have tomatoes. You like cucumbers? You like tomatoes? Tomatoes, you never know. The cucumbers, the nice thing about cucumbers is that they come up quickly, and we've already eaten several. Now, they weren't very big cucumbers. They were sort of small cucumbers, but they were very delicious. And the tomatoes, well, tomatoes take a lot longer before they're ripe and ready to eat. But our tomato plants have, one of them has six tomatoes growing on it. They're well, some of them are getting a little bit big already. And the other one has 8 or 10 tomatoes. And they're so heavy, it's leaning the plant over and to one side. Now, why do you think we're growing those tomatoes and those cucumbers? You think we might hope to eat some of them? And because we want these plants to make the fruit for us to eat, we're good to them. I water the cucumbers and the tomatoes, especially the tomatoes, every day, because they're in these pots and they dry out. And I put plant food on them a couple times a week to help them grow so that they'll have maybe a little bit bigger cucumbers and certainly nice red tomatoes. Now, we just heard a story about grapevines. And I think most of us know more about tomatoes than about grapevines. But the point was that God gives us all kinds of good things. God made a beautiful world for us to live in, and plants to grow, to eat, and all kinds of good things to provide all the things we need for a good life. And what God expects is that we will be fruitful, that we will do good things, that we'll be kind to our neighbors, that we will help the world be a better place. And sometimes that doesn't happen. Sometimes it may take a long time for this fruit to get ripe, like those tomatoes that we have. But God wants us to grow up, to bear fruit, to have good things come out of our lives, and not just to be, well, I have to admit, our cucumber plants have gotten about to the end, and they're starting to wilt and fade. And that can happen to people too, that if you aren't producing fruit, that you get to fade away sort of into nothing. So I'm encouraging us all to be fruitful people, bear good fruit in the things that we do, in the things that we say to folks, and in the love that we all share together. So shall we pray? Oh God, you have planted us here in this beautiful world. Help us, we pray, to grow up, to bear good fruit for you. You have prepared the world for us like we prepare the soil for the plants that we grow. And you have watered us and fed us and brought us to this time. Help us to continue to grow in your love, that we may be fruitful people here in your lovely world. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
And our
Oh, there's a response here. Holy wisdom, holy word. Okay. We have a reading from the New Testament, from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 12. We'll be starting at the 49th verse. This is Jesus talking to his disciples and to the crowd. He says, "I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They shall be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." Jesus also said to the crowds, "When you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, 'It's going to rain.' And so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, 'There will be scorching heat.' And it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time?" This is the word of God. Holy wisdom, holy word. The life and teaching of Jesus caused a crisis in the world, perhaps the greatest crisis in history. At the time Jesus lived, the Mediterranean world had just gone through 50 years of chaos and uncertainty. How many years of chaos and uncertainty of a different kind? There'd been a series of changes in the Roman government and civil war in the Roman Empire, which had unsettled all the lands around the Mediterranean. It had been a time when trade was interrupted, when allegiances were constantly changed, and when lack of dependable governance allowed pirates and robbers free rein. Then Caesar Augustus, now you may remember him in the story that Luke tells about the Christmas, about the birth of Jesus. Augustus's army won the decisive battle over his Roman rivals and brought peace to his world, the Pax Romana, Roman peace. With effective government now in place over the whole Mediterranean world, the economy improved, and people became accustomed to things being back to normal. With Roman legions stationed in every country around the Mediterranean, there was little danger of an uprising causing significant change in the social order. It was a time of peace and order. So when Jesus began his preaching, a lot of people were quite happy with the situation in their lives. Things in Galilee, where he had grown up, were pretty quiet and peaceful. Now, once a revolt a few years earlier had been put down and hundreds of freedom fighters had been crucified, life had returned to normal, and people didn't want any more trouble with the Roman occupiers. In Jerusalem, the religious authorities had reached a comfortable accommodation with the Romans so that worship could go along smoothly in the temple, controlled by the priests and the Sadducees under the watchful eyes of the soldiers who were there in the fortress that was just next door. But Jesus had become to teach a new order of society, the kingdom of God. And he invited his followers to live as citizens of that realm that was even now breaking into the world. It would be a world built on love rather than on conquest, competition, oppression, and the threat of violence. What a revolutionary idea. Through his teaching and by his example, Jesus offered a new way to live as human beings, the way of love. He broke down all the social barriers that separate people in our society, the barriers of race, of gender, of national origin, of social class. For he showed himself willing to sit and share a meal with just anybody. Jesus warned against the tyranny of money and possessions and the difficulty that rich people would have entering God's kingdom. He called for the social order to be turned upside down, where the first would be last and the last first. That was fiery preaching, and it certainly brought division. The authorities, both civil and religious, saw Jesus' message as a threat to their power. And when he preached it at a festival where there were crowds of people, they had him arrested, tried, and executed as an enemy of the public. The movement that his followers continued got its members expelled from their families' places of worship. So they set up alternative, competing houses of worship with separate congregations. And over the next centuries, families were bitterly divided when some family members chose to follow Jesus rather than their traditional religion and customs. Even today, the message that Jesus brought causes division in families, in communities, and in nations. Are all people equally children of God, deserving respect and to be treated fairly, both in the social sphere, by the legal system, as well as in politics and economics? Or are there some people who are more entitled to rights and justice than others? That question, which Jesus poses to us as a challenge by his words and his actions, is causing sharp, often violent divisions in our communities and in our nation today. Is the right way for people to relate to one another by treating each other with love? Or are we to confront them with threats of violence in order to protect our own interests? People in our communities have strong, differing opinions about Jesus' instruction to love our enemies. Is it right that people in positions of prestige, power, and wealth should remain ahead of those currently on top? Jesus said that people in our society who now enjoy their privileged access to the gifts in heaven. Jesus brought fire upon the earth, as that old saying, today as it did in Jesus' time. Today as it did in Jesus' time. But for a lot of people who heard Jesus' day and life in America today, are the signs of the times any more mysterious than the indications about the weather? Although I know for a lot of us, we've gotten used to learning about the weather by looking at a screen rather than at the sky. Modern technology has meant that on the surface, life today looks very different from life in Jesus' day. But the concerns that we face, the crises of our time, are deep down, not much different from those that were addressed or weren't addressed by Jesus in Jesus' day. There are a number of crises that we are facing, and I won't bore you by mentioning some of them. But although some of those crises could not have developed without modern technology, it's the age-old propensity for humans to act in destructive ways that is the underlying cause of most of the crises we face, and that prevents us from addressing them effectively. There are some people these days who have heard and rejected Jesus' admonition to practice love, and who persist in following hate, greed, prejudice, coercion, and exploitation as the guides for their behavior. But more people today have never heard the good news that Jesus announced a new kingdom of love. In America, the Christian faith is often represented as a religion of rules, as a pillar supporting the American way of life, as belief in an angry, vengeful God who will punish us for any mistake that we make. And if people haven't been turned off from Christianity by that erroneous perception, they may simply be convinced that there is no other alternative to the way of life they experience around them, because it is God's will, or simply human nature, and nothing can change it. Jesus, on the other hand, taught and showed us that there is an alternative, another way to be human. The way of love. And that's how I read the signs of our times. We live in a time of crisis, of several crises, some worldwide, some centered in the United States. They are primarily the consequences to be expected from a world order much like that of Jesus' time. And the division that he brought between those who benefit from the injustices of the way our society is currently organized, and those who strive to live the new way of life that Jesus taught. That division is very visible among us. At the risk of sounding simplistic, I'm convinced that a major part of the long-term solutions for many of these crises is for people to change from the belief that prestige, power, possessions, And the position of being more deserving than others are the keys to a successful and enjoyable life. Instead, as more people try to live as citizens of the kingdom of God, treating others as equally entitled to the gifts of God's creation, and recognizing love and concern for the well-being of all as the highest good, then the barriers that get in the way of addressing the crises we face will be less formidable, and our world will become a better place for everyone. Now, I think that all of us can contribute toward making this time of crisis an opportunity for bringing the kingdom of God closer to a living, visible reality. We can share the good news that God, that Jesus preached and demonstrated in our words and in the way that we live our lives, showing that there is a different way from the pattern of life that we see around us, a way that is not driven by greed, fear, hatred, coercion, and exploitation, but it is guided by love. Love for God, love for God's kingdom, love for God's earth, and love for all the other people who share it with us. When the fire of God's Spirit, revealed through Jesus, blazes in our life and is shared in our words, the whole world can be changed from crisis to peace, and the divisions that plague a world in crisis can indeed be healed in the new life that Jesus calls us to be part of. How's that for a message of hope? I pray that all of us can embrace Christ's call to bring light into the darkness that is a sign of our times. Amen.
God's time is near. God's time is near. God's
Thank you so much for sharing that. I think they probably put into words accompanied by music in a more concise way the message that I had for us this morning. Thank you. Let us come into God's presence in prayer. O gracious and merciful God, in the warmth of this summer morning, we rest ourselves in your presence. In a world where everything seems to be changing almost daily, the presence of your love and care for us is always the same. Lord, you have opened the way to new life, to life in your divine kingdom, for all who put their trust in your Son Jesus and who follow the path that he taught and that he modeled in his own life. We pray that we may hear his invitation in our lives and in the life of this church. We would like to understand your intention for how we should live as Jesus did. We would like to share in his vision of your kingdom, of the way it reorders people's lives and redirects priorities and transforms societies in truth and love. Lord, in these troubled days, we pray that you would guide us and our leaders as we seek the path to recovery and renewal from the pandemic that still lurks in our land. Pour out your spirit of comfort on the families of the hundreds of thousands who have been killed by the COVID virus, and grant recovery and healing to those who are currently ill with the disease and those still suffering its long-term effects. Give your spirit of compassion and skill to the doctors, nurses, and aides who have been ministering for over 2 years to those who are ill. And give us all the consideration for others to take the steps that will help limit the spread of new strains of this disease. O God of compassion, we pray that you will bless all of your children who are troubled this day by sickness or injury or confused minds or broken relationships or physical needs. Especially, we pray for those whose need we mention in our silent prayers, as well as those whose need is known only to you. Pour out your spirit of healing upon them all. Lord, we pray for those who are victims of natural disasters and of human-caused disasters. Pour out your spirit of strength, hope, and comfort upon those affected by wildfires in the West Coast, by floods in Kentucky and elsewhere, and give us all the wisdom and the willingness to do what is needed to limit the impact of global climate change. We pray that you would be with the people of Ukraine as they suffer in the throes of war. Protect them in the midst of the death and destruction, and hasten the return of peace to their country. And send your spirit of peace to all the places of civil unrest and violence to Gaza, and to the other areas of this unsettled world. Protect us in our nation, Lord, where children fear for their lives when they go to school, and where shopping or celebrating brings the risk of being killed. Lord, help us to love one another and deliver us from hatred and murder and bring peace to our violent world. O Lord of the universe, guide the leaders of our nation and of every nation into pathways of justice, mercy, and peace, that they may be both loving and bold in their actions. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray, using the words that he taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. God has blessed us more than we can imagine. And out of our gratitude and thanksgiving for what God has given to us, let us now dedicate our offering of our goods and our offering of ourselves for the work of God's kingdom through this church. Pray. O Lord, we give you thanks for all of your gifts to us. We praise you that you have sent your Son Jesus to show us the way to new life and to open the door to your kingdom. We bless you for creating this wonderful world, so beautiful and so full of all of the things that we need for a full life. And we thank you for the gift of your Spirit that inflames our hearts and guides our lives as we seek to be citizens of your heavenly kingdom. Accept now these tokens of what you have given to us that we return to you for the work of your church. Through them, may the love of Christ and our concern for your world be made known here in this community and across the world. For we pray, ask in Jesus' name. Amen.